this particular course is a highly technical course, and it is highly advisable that if you are taking this course, you try as much as possible to achieve these three things. One, as much as possible, try to attend the classes. Two, you need a computer system with at least 48 gig RAM. Okay, with at least 48 gig RAM, you need that system. And the reason is because of the lab activities that we're going to have. And then number three, you should be able to do the lab activities we're going to be doing. Now, this course has so many lab activities, so many of them. All right, so the course is going to be very engaging. But today's class is usually the first class. We are going to be looking at module one. But before we go to module one, there are certain things we need to agree upon. The first thing is the number of times we are going to be meeting. Based on the mail I sent you guys, we are going to be meeting three times in a week: Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. If it three times is at least three times, if these 3 days are not convenient, maybe we can look at other days, but it has to be three times in a week. So I'm recommending Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. And the reason is because Tuesdays, Thursdays, and weekends, I am going to be giving you a lot of lab activities to be doing. So, but based on your own work schedule, I don't know if the days are okay for you, then we can reschedule it maybe to other days of the week, but it has to be three times. The second thing is the timing. For this schedule, today and Wednesday, I scheduled the meeting for 3 p.m. Now, I noticed in the previous classes that I have been taking, I've been having a lot of engagement that was clashing with this, and I was not too happy with my schedules. So, but this time around, I'm trying to see if we can look at the evenings or probably the nights. But I don't know the convenience for you guys, whether the evenings are okay or we should go down. Maybe this is 3 p.m. or maybe we should go down to 6 or 7 p.m. or whatever, evenings or nights or whatever. If none of it is convenient for you people, then we would have to maybe think of maybe one of the days that we look at in the mornings. So I am thinking Friday. Friday we can meet in the mornings so that those who are going to mosque would be able to have time to go for prayers. But these other days, I am proposing evenings. So I want you to think about it. But for today's class and Wednesday class is scheduled for 3 p.m. So I'm going to go to the WhatsApp group after the class. I'm going to be observing your discussions. So I want people to indicate what timing they prefer. Then, based on that, I will now reschedule next week's class to suit our timing. All right. So, having said that, I want to once again welcome you for CCNA's Cybersecurity Operations course. And this course has 28 modules. 28 modules. And we intend to finish this course in by second week of November, first or second week of November. When I say finish this course, I'm not talking about finish the lecture. I'm talking about we need to finish exams. I need to be graduating the class by second week of November. So, which simply means that when we meet, we are going to see how fast we can be moving. It is not everything I am going to cover in details, so that we can be able to cover within the stipulated time. But I am going to give a lot of time for the hands-on. So there are certain chapters that I'm just going to now focus on the hands-on, if I see that the topic has been covered enough. Then lastly, I'm going to create a link maybe by tomorrow, where I am going to dump the materials for this course, the PowerPoint, and the lab activities that I'm going to be giving you people. So I'm going to create a link and then drop the link for you people on the WhatsApp group. Okay, so module one talks about the danger. The danger. Now, hackers can set up open hole wireless hotspot, posing as a genuine wireless network. So rogue wireless hotspots are also known as evil twin hotspots. Okay, so the point we are seeing here is that we're starting with wireless. And the hotspot that we often know, somebody can set up the same hotspot with the same SSID. This is the SSID is the service set identifier that is being broadcasted for people to be able to connect it. So that is a big danger that is being posed. So employees of organizations are often lured into opening attachments that install ransomwares on employees' computers. That is another danger. You receive emails from sources you are not sure of, and then it's downloaded to your organization's system. So that way it can affect some other services that you are running. So this ransomware, when installed, begins the process of gathering and encrypting corporate data. Now, in our cybersecurity essentials class, we talked a lot about ransomware. But in a summary, it is just a malware that actually encrypts all your files or your system and locks you out of it so that you do not have access. And then a message is sent to you to pay a ransom. So once you pay that particular ransom, then the access is being released to you. So the ransomware is what we are talking about. So it is also a danger. We have looked at the wireless, now the ransomware. So the goal of the attackers is financial gain because they hold the company's data for ransom until it is paid. Then we have another danger. Some of today's malware is sophisticated and expensive to create that security experts believe only a nation state or group of nations could possibly have the influence or funding to create it. Such malware can be targeted to attack a nation's vulnerable infrastructure, such the water system or power grid. So we are looking at a situation, another danger, where organizations or companies or countries or group of countries can produce a particular malware to attack a particular major facility in the country. It could be the water system, it could be the power grid, it could be the solar panel, it could be the oil sector or whatever it is. So such such malware was the Stuxnet worm that infected USB drives and infected Windows operating system. It then targeted Step 7 softwares that were developed by Siemens for their programmable logic controllers. So that was an example of this particular kind of malware. Still, we are talking about dangers. We have seen how hotspot, somebody can set up a twin rogue hotspot and to gain access to the network. We have seen where somebody will send unsolicited emails to an employer. And that particular person is going to gain access to resources in the network. We have seen how ransomware are sent to a particular network and all the files are encrypted, you know, and things like that. So we have also seen how nations are being targeted, you know. So all these are dangers that we have. So what are our threat actors? Threat actors basically are just like individuals or group of individuals who actually perform these cyber attacks. They are like the source that of this problem that we are discovering. So they are the threat actors. So some of them are categorized as amateur hackers. Some of them are categorized as activists. Some of them are categorized as organized crime groups. Some of them are categorized as state-sponsored groups. And some of them are even organized grouped as terrorist groups. So all these cyber attacks and threat actors are like groups. And what helps to group them is the characteristics, how they do their attack, the motive they go behind the attack, and who is the sponsor. This is how they are grouped. So cyber attackers are international malicious acts that's meant to negatively impact other individuals or organizations. All right? So amateur hackers, sometimes we call them script kiddies. All right? And the reason we do that is because they are not like very advanced in the hacking skills. So they often use exploit existing tools or instructions found on the internet to launch an attack. So they are like learners in the hacking industry. They just go into the web and look for skills, it's devastating. So, and some of them, they just do that for fun or trying to experiment. Experiment their abilities. Sorry. Okay, sorry, can you guys hear me? All right. So some of them are trying to experiment their skills or their abilities. So most of the times we call them amateur hackers. Now, we have the hacktivists, and these are hackers who publicly protest against a variety of political and social ideas, all right? So the post articles and videos leaking sensitive information and disrupting web services with illegitimate traffic in distributed denial of service. All right. So, like some people think that activists have good motives for whatever hacking things they have done. Okay. But I don't think that is the point. The point basically is that whatever it is they have done is devastating. So it is important to note that hacktivists, basically, this group of people, they have a goal. And this their goal is like either they are fighting for their right, or they are fighting for the poor masses, or they are fighting the government against certain kind of policies that the government have implemented or whatever. So let's say there's price increment in fuel, or maybe there is price increment in electricity tariff, there's price increment in certain things. So this group of people will come together and see how they will use their skills in order to fight the government. So they will hack into certain facilities to expose certain videos, certain documents. So that those are the hacktivists, right? Then we have the ones for financial gain. So much of the hacking activity that consistently threatens our society is motivated by financial gain. So cyber criminals want to gain access to bank accounts, personal data, and anything else that they can leverage to generate cash flow. And so they result in sending fraudulent emails claiming to be from the bank and things like that. And they will enable you to want you to click on the link and put in your bank details and your card details. All right. That is one of the ways that they go about it. But the whole aim is they are doing that for financial gain. Then trade secrets and global policies, politics. So at times, nation states hack other countries or interfere with other internal politics. So often they may be interested in using cyberspace for industrial espionage. So the theft of intellectual property can give a country a significant advantage in the international trade. So these are all part of the threat actors that we're talking about. Now, the Internet of Things helps individuals to connect things, improve their quality of life. So many devices on the internet are not updated with the latest firmware. So some older devices are not even developed to be updated with patches. So these two situations create opportunity for threat actors and security risk for the owners of these devices. Like you can see here, all these particular organized, this is like a smart city, and within this smart city, or a smart home, you see you have your cooker, which is on the network, your laptop or your TV, your air condition, your drawer, you know, your washing machine, your fridge, your microwave, your house, everything you have is on the internet. And that is where the world is going as regards technology now. So the Internet of Things is where the world is going. And because of that, threat actors are gaining grounds and they are gaining advantage to create a lot of mayhem on people. Now, as regards PII or PHI and PSI, what does that mean? All right, PII simply means personally identifiable information, and is any information that can be used to positively identify an individual, maybe your name or your driver's license or a number or your BVN number or your date of birth or your credit card number, any information that once it's been taken, or your company file number or your organization's email address or whatever it is, any information that once somebody gets access to it, he can find out information about your personality, all right? And even your phone number these days can also be used for that. So that is called PII, or personally identifiable information. So any information that anyone can use to gain to know details about you, you have to find a way of protecting it. Then we have cyber criminals aim to obtain this list of PII that can then be sold in the dark web. Stolen PII can be used to create fake financial accounts such as credit cards and short-term loans. And that is it. People do a lot of identity theft now. And apart from identity theft, they do a lot of fake details. So somebody will now register with your name and then will go and carry out a crime and will claim to be you. All right, that is a problem, all right? So the medical community creates the and maintains the electronic medical records, all right, that contain protected health information, a subset of PII. So PHI is protected health information, all right? In advanced countries, your social security number has a lot of information about your health. Because when you go to the hospital, you are asked to provide your social security number. And with that, all your details, your health files, your fees, your tests, and everything are documented there. So the PHI, which is a subset of the PII, because if they gain access to that, they can know personal information about you. Now, how about the PSI? PSI means personal security information, which is another type of PII, which includes your username, your password, and other security-related information that individuals can use to access information or services on your network. So if somebody gains access to my email address or my email address password, the person has a lot of information about my PII. And so it is important to protect your information and yourself from all these threat actors. Now, the loss of intellectual property to competitors is a serious concern. An additional major concern is the loss of trust that comes when a company is unable to protect its customers' personal data. And that is true. I want you to just imagine that MTN is being hacked, or your bank. Maybe you have a particular bank you bank with, and then the bank is being hacked. And a lot of information about you is there. A lot of information about your financial transaction is there. So the loss of competitive advantage may come from loss of trust rather than another company or country stealing trade secrets. Okay, so that is some of the impact that these threat actors can negatively cause on our personality. How about politics and national security? It is not just business that get hacked. State-supported hackers, warriors, can cause disruption and destruction of vital services and resources within an enemy nation. So the internet has become essential as a medium for commercial and financial activities. So disruption of these activities can devastate the nation's economy. And that is very, very, very true. Okay? So that is in all what we have for chapter one. It is a very, very brief chapter that we have. But what I would want you guys to do, just hold on. Let me show you guys what I would want you guys to do. Just hold on just a moment. Sorry, I'm trying to launch the class so that I will show you guys. So that I'll show you the lab activities and what we need to do before Wednesday. Okay. Okay. Okay, let me share my screen so that I can show you guys. Okay, sorry, I'm silent. Where is this thing? Thank you very much for attending today's course, The Danger in Chapter 1. And I look forward to seeing you on Wednesday, the same time. But before Wednesday, by Wednesday, we should have concluded the timing of our classes and the days of our classes. So I'll be monitoring the WhatsApp chat. So feel free to express yourself on the WhatsApp, so that we can know how best to go ahead. Okay, thank you very much. If there is any question, I would be available to take the questions now. Any question?
Hello, good afternoon.